It's Micah. Welcome to our Friday reaction series where we're listening to the entire discography of Janet Jackson. It's all Janet, all Friday, all for you. Today, we will be listening to Janet's first number one single and the sixth track on the Control album out of nine tracks, When I Think of You. And our swag this week is also When I Think of You. This is a series of remixes that came out in 1995. This one in particular is an English import. It's a little bit damaged from transport and storage over the years, but the album is in here. Ta-da! I don't think that I've ever listened to this actually, but I know I've heard these on CD. Well, I'm pretty sure I have, unless. I'm pretty sure I've heard all of these mixes on CDs. Not so much into remixes, I'm more so into listening to the albums all the way through. But these were released in conjunction with the Design of a Decade project, where she was revisiting, of course, the songs and the hits of the past 10 years of her career in 1995. And of course that encompassed Control. So happy to have this in my collection. What we're going to be looking at today is the music video for When I Think of You, which was directed by Julian Temple, and he also directed the video for All Right from the Rhythm Nation album. You can see there are definite similarities in the two videos. The central like gimmick of this video is that it's a one-shot take video. I can't say for sure that this is the first music video that tried this technique. But it is an early adopter, I'll put it that way. The video I think actually occurs in three takes, but given the complexity of this production, even doing it in three takes, it had to have taken lots of rehearsal. So I still am in awe of how this video was done. The choreography is by Paula Abdul. This was the last video that she would choreograph for Janet, if I'm not mistaken. She did What Have You Done For Me Lately, then she did Nasty, and we've looked at both of those in past weeks, and this was her third and final choreography job with Janet for When I Think of You. And you can definitely see some of the Paula trademarks with the highly gestural choreography and the way that she has her dancers moving through space. So yeah, let's just get into the video. I could just go on for days and days about Janet. Let's just watch the video.
Beat it!
because of an error on my part, I ended up watching that all the way through twice. The first time I didn't have my video capture on, so you couldn't see what I was reacting to. But because of that, I was able to take in the visuals to the video twice and then possibly get a little more out of the music. There's so much going on with this music video, it's almost easy to like miss a big chunks of what's going on in the music, and that's pretty important to what's going on here. I do think that the mix, I'll talk about the music first. I do think that the mix, the video mix of this almost puts the music more in the background, if that makes sense. The album version of this is very, very immediate and very front and center, but the mix almost places the original song in a bigger box with a, it's almost like there's an echo effect that almost reduces the immediacy of it to my ears. So I don't get quite as much wallop from like all the great instrumentation that's going on here. Notably, Terry Lewis's bass on this is really intricate and very jammy. There's a lot of little do-do-do-do-do-do. There's a lot of that going on. It's really, really cool. The building of the song, layer upon layer, is way more obvious to me. And part of this, again, may be the visuals. The visuals are such overload here that you're not getting to just focus in on what's happening with the track. But the way that it starts off with just the ding, 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 ding. It starts off with that. And then the percussion really kicks in, and then the bass kicks in, and then extra layer comes in, and then the synth, the horn synths, which they pantomimed in the video using actual horns, by the time Janet comes in with her really sweet vocals, you're already kind of full and kind of full of anticipation and just full of music in your ears. And so it's a very fun experience listening to this record. When this song came out, it's so funny. I was a little bit worried that Janet was already starting to soften her image too much. That after those first two hard-hitting singles, here she was back grinning ear to ear and being more of a girly girl. And like I thought, well, is it already over? Are we already back to Janet the way she used to be? Is everyone going to be okay with this? How is this going to play? And much to my surprise, this became her biggest charting hit on the pop charts yet. Funny enough, over the years, even though Janet has this image as an edgy, well, depending on who you're talking to, like most, there's a contingent of people who only see Janet as this pop artist, and they'll point to these number one songs, and almost without fail, her number one songs have been the poppier, happier, or more lovesick songs without a whole lot of emotional edginess or a lot of creative edginess. The one exception being Black Cat, I think. But for people who really know her music, it's very interesting that she kind of has an image as a really groundbreaking artist with a lot of intense lyrical content and forward-looking musical content. But none of those songs ever attained the stratospheric heights of some of these other number one hits. So there's almost this duality with her because of that. So that was my concern at the time. And looking back on it, I was thinking during the video, was Joe Jackson like really, really ticked off when he saw how successful this song was? I feel like this presentation of Janet, it was completely what he had in his mind that she was going to be as a superstar. His sweet little girl singing cooing love songs and blowing up the charts. I think that's what he thought was going to happen, but it did not happen under his watch. But what Jimmy and Terry did, along with Janet, was to round out her image. And once you saw that she could have these tough edges, it made her a more well-rounded musical personality, where you could stomach the more saccharine presentations of her. In addition to that, there's a lot of musical heft going on with this song, even though the lyric is a very sweet lyric. Some people have said, lyrically speaking, that this song is also about control, that she's owning the she's owning the relationship. She's making it about her and what her whims are, because this is about when I think of you. But everyone's going to sing a song from their own perspective, so I don't think there's a feminist message really embedded in here. I more so think this is just a fun time kind of song and a way to balance out some of the other harsher messages on the album and to make it clear that she's not against relationships, not against love. She just is acknowledging that she's had some difficulties in her own life, but it doesn't stop her from being hopeful and being sort of doe-eyed and starry-eyed and in love, just like anybody else, susceptible to the same sort of softer feelings as everybody else. And this song captures that really nicely, and with a degree of emotional buy-in from Janet that, again, you do not hear on somewhat similar songs from the earlier albums, where she's cooing about being in love, but you kind of don't really believe her as much. Now, having spoken about the music, let's look at that video. Choreography, great. Not the best, in my opinion, but great. I think that one little breakdown with the bass line, where she was on the stage and then the people in the audience were also dancing in sync with her, that little routine was my favorite part of the video. And the fact that it accompanies the sort of the bass solo, for lack of a better word of it, where the bass is more prominent in that breakdown, I felt like the choreography worked best there and was more funky. Everywhere else in the video, it's more or less wallpaper to the set design, and not so much its own feature, like it is in the other music videos, or typically as front and center as it is with the choreography in her other videos. But the cinematography, set design, outstanding. And again, we're talking about, and I said this last week with the Pleasure Principle, we're looking at music videos are still a fairly new art form at this point, and the amount of progress they were making in like making videos into real short films and making them into real cohesive pieces of art, it had come such a long way. And of course, Michael played a big role in making that happen. And I feel like Janet advanced the art form that much further with the videos for the Control album. My final note is, I mentioned when I was reacting to Nasty and What Have You Done For Me Lately, that these first three videos are kind of a trilogy that follow some similar tropes. And to me, the overarching thing is this playing with this idea of Hollywood or stage sets or movie sets versus real life. In the What Have You Done For Me Lately video, they go back and forth between a real life set of the diner that the action takes place in, and this cartoon version, this cartoon two-dimensional version of it, where they're doing all the musical stuff, where they're doing the choreography, and so it's almost like what's going on in reality and what's going on in their heads, which is the part where the psychological pieces are represented by the dancing or the interactional pieces between the people in the video, between her and her boyfriend, are happening in her mind, and this is her visualization of it. So it goes back and forth between those two set pieces, which are sort of in the same place but two different versions, reality versus this cartoon-like setup. Then in the Nasty video, she's being bombarded by these catcalling guys in real life in the movie theater, but then she actually backflips into the movie that she's watching and uses that as a set piece to do all the singing and dancing and talking about and expressing herself again. Again, the song, the dancing, is actually the part where she's interacting on a psychological level. It's almost like a fantasy representation of what's going on. And to me, it's this music. It's sort of directly addressing this whole the big joke about how, you know, musicals are unrealistic because people randomly break into song and dance. And she seems to be deconstructing that idea, or the director she's using, or deconstructing that idea down into, okay, well, this isn't what people would really do, but by representing what they would do or how they're feeling mentally in the form of this fantasy sequence, then now we're playing by the rules, and we have explained why people are singing and dancing, because it's not the real thing. Finally, in this video, and when I think of you, the set here is so obviously a sound. You don't see the wires and the lights and the microphones and everything, but the setup is so obviously a studio set that basically anyone watching this video could tell that this isn't happening outside, even though it's set outside. It looks exactly like a soundstage. It looks very old school Hollywood. It's very self-aware about the fact that it's a big fantasy sequence. So, but it doesn't actually tip its hand by flipping back into reality, but it does self-acknowledge by the extremity of the design, because you don't actually see the sky at any point. It's not realistic in any, or naturalistic in any real meaningful way, but they still go through the motions of doing everything and having all the action take place on this set piece, but it's very obviously a set. So, but all three of these videos play with that idea, and it also kind of subconsciously places Janet in that milieu, I've always wanted to use that word, of being a Hollywood legend or being part of that tradition. And I think this was a really ingenious way of establishing her, especially in the early stages of her superstardom, as someone who lives in this world, who grew up in this world, as a matter of fact. And so for me, it's a perfect way to introduce her visually. So much about the Control Project was just sheer genius on so many levels: the music, the message, the visuals, the choreography. There's just like a perfect storm of really, really great forward-thinking artistry going on in this album. It's what made me a fan. It's what ended up making me a lifelong fan of hers. And so, good job, Janet. She needed my validation. She was waiting on that, I can tell. Next week, we're going to be getting into a non-single from the album. It's He Doesn't Know I'm Alive, so we'll just be listening next week instead of really actively watching a music video. And stay tuned for that. Until then, please like this video if you indeed liked it. Please hit the subscribe button if you would, or whatever the configuration is on your user interface. Just subscribe. That's my point. And please make music better.